Oh, this is Mitchie 95. I already said that, didn't I? At the risk of repeating myself, I am Mitchie G. Okay, shut up, Jimmy. Just continue with the show. So I got in touch with these guys, okay, who are doing some fabulous work in trying to restore the heritage of our city, of our culture. And let's go straight into that conversation. Vinay, good morning.
Good morning.
You are on a mission to save something very old in our city of Bangalore. What is this and why have you gotten on this mission?
I don't know where to begin because it's so exciting.
So let's begin maybe 10,000 years ago.
There are these stone tablets which have inscriptions on them.
Okay.
And the earliest ones are from 750 AD. So that's about 1200 years ago.
Wow.
So that is where we have the earliest evidence of any human being having written in a language in Bangalore.
Okay.
There is knowledge transfer from 1200 years ago.
Huh.
And that caught me. I'm like, wow, somebody has communicated something and let's try and see what it is.
Okay.
And shockingly, most of these stones on which people of the past have written are lying on the street side, in footpaths, on covering drains, lining sewage channels and whatnot.
I mean, I don't understand. They've been used for this or they're just generally lying around and people are not aware of it?
Yes, they're lying around, people are not aware of it, and some of them have been used for drains as well, drains and footpath covers.
Oh, because people didn't know what they were.
Yeah, people didn't know what it is, and there are so many myths surrounding these stones as to what they are.
Right.
My cycling buddy Uday and I, chanced upon one such stone after having listened to a talk about these stones.
Uh-huh.
We started looking at, trying to find where these stones are located, and when we visited the first stone in Peenya,
huh?
Peenya Dasarhalli, we were shocked to see where it is and the state in which it is. A particular stone is over 1,000 years old.
It the one in Peenya.
It has a beautiful sculpture of a man who is being pierced by arrows. And so this is not a villain, but this is a hero who died fighting for his cattle.
For his cattle, okay.
For his cattle.
Right.
And that is what is written above it as well in old Kannada. You know, Kannada is known to have originated somewhere around the 3rd century or 4th century.
Okay. Yes.
Somewhere in the region of near Hasan. And just about 200 years after that, Kannada was being spoken in Peenya.
Okay.
And that is how fresh it is. It is like very close to the origins of the language that we speak here in Bangalore.
Right.
That was, the trigger point for us. When we saw this, it's like something that's as old and as precious as this. It's just lying in a vacant land. And when we were there, we saw a lady come by and perform some prayer and puja. And she applied vermilion and turmeric to the stone.
Okay.
And just a few minutes after this lady passed by, a dog came by and urinated on the stone. We were like shocked. I mean, like, what's happening?
You know, this must be like searching for a needle in a haystack. How do you start searching at all?
100 years ago, a Britisher by name B.L. Rice, he knew Kannada, is an expert of languages. He was actually an English teacher.
Okay.
But he had keen interest in archaeology. And over the period of years, he started documenting these inscription stones. He has compiled a book of over 9,000 inscriptions across the old Mysore state.
Okay.
We were like, okay, can we retrace his path? Let's try and see. And we came to know that there were over 150 such stones he had documented in the Bangalore region. We were like, let us try and use technology to see how we can preserve or save these stones. When we began, it was like, okay, where do we search? And you know what the landmarks are like? It says, this stone was found under a peepal tree next to Ramappa's farm. Okay, in some Dasrali. Now, today there is no people tree because Bangalore is developing and we don't need trees. People are cutting trees left, right and center. Okay.
And there is no Ramappa also.
There's no Ramappa, there's no field.
Right.
So, where do we go? So, we usually start off narrowing down on the kind of the largest area that is mentioned in the book and the next nearest name that is available today. So, Peenya is a fairly new name.
Right.
Today. So, Dasrali was what it was called 100 years ago.
Okay. Okay.
The closest other names that are mentioned in and around that area is Yelahanka.
Huh.
So, Yelahanka is a very old locality which is over 600 years old and its name is still exists. So, we know that, okay, this Dasrali is closer to Yelahanka. So, it's like working based on clues. And then we land up at Dasrali and try and locate the oldest part around there, which invariably you'll find a banyan tree or a people tree or a government school or some sort of a public property. And then we ask around people. Invariably, we end up with the oldest person in the locality. So, the oldest person around in that locality would tell us, okay, I've seen this in my childhood. There used to be this stone where we were playing around. You know, something was written. We didn't know what was written.
Huh.
You know, there are so many myths surrounding what is written on the stones. Is that some people say, oh, so you are a treasure hunter, so you know where the treasure is and you can read this language. So please tell us where the treasure is. Okay?
Huh.
And there have been people who said, so we have heard that whoever reads this, their head will explode. So please don't read it. And there have been others who said, people have told us that this cannot be read straightforward. So you have to tilt your head upside down and read it.
Which is when your head will explode.
Or maybe it'll prevent your head from exploding. There are also people who say, oh, these stones are cursed, so please don't read them because, you know, you'll invite a curse upon yourself.
I'm like, hey, Namaskara, what's up, Bangalore?
This is Mirchi 95. I am Mirchi Jimmy. I'm in conversation with Vinay and Uday. Actually, only Vinay, but Vinay and Uday are the inscription stone hunters from Bangalore. Look for them, Inscription Stones Bangalore, on Facebook and Twitter. They are on a mission to hunt down inscription stones that were written almost 1,200 years ago and are there across the city of Bangalore, 150 that have been documented. Now, Vinay, you were telling me that the villagers have told you that if you read it, you could invoke a curse upon yourself. Have you come across curses on these stones?
Basically, these stones are edicts, comparable to what is today's gazette, which is published by the government.
Okay.
So, back in the day when there was no government, this is how the king would put out a new rule which applies to that locality.
Okay.
For example, a king built a lake.
Hmm.
So for the people, so he would. This would serve as an inaugural stone.
Okay.
Where the king would say, okay, I built this lake and this is for the people. I dedicated this to the villagers now, and it is their duty to maintain this.
Right.
And he also writes very often that whoever maintains this will prosper.
Okay.
And whoever doesn't maintain will invite a curse upon themselves. One of my favorite curses which we discovered in April this year is from Pattandur Lake, which is in the middle of a huge controversy today. Pattandur is near Whitefield. So when the people in that area woke up to some kind of dumping in this land, they were shocked. They're like, we know that this is a lake. Why is debris being dumped here?
Huh.
And they dug up and found out that this is like actually a lake, but somewhere in the past some corruption has happened and people have taken ownership of this land
illegally. Okay.
And they filed a case in the court. And in the process, they also had heard somewhere that, you know, there could be some inscription which mentions of this lake.
Hmm.
And that is when they reached out to us.
Oh, okay.
And we started looking out. Okay, let's see what is there. And to our surprise, we found an inscription stone in a graveyard.
Okay.
Which talks about this lake. And it is during the reign of Rajaraja Chola in the 9th century.
Wow.
He commissioned this lake to be built by a local chieftain.
Okay.
And mentioned that those who maintain this will prosper. And here's the interesting part, okay? The last line says, those who don't maintain this will invoke the sin of killing thousands of people from Ganga to Kanyakumari.
Okay.
And also become the husband of their mother.
What? The husband of their mother?
Exactly. And this is what has been documented 100 years ago. So that's how obnoxious these curses were.
It's probably so, where the MCBCs also of the world originated at some level.
Actually, yeah. See, MCBC is all recent, okay? I think our ancestors were way ahead of all this.
In fact, apparently now that the stone has been discovered, the High Court is saying this is admissible proof in court and has stayed the construction on Pattanur Lake. Such fantastic stories coming out today. One more. I think I have space for one more. Stay tuned. This is Mirchi 95. I'm Mirchi Jimmy. Mirchi sunne wale. Always khush.
I'm like, hey, namaskara. What's up, Bangalore?
This is Mirchi 95. I'm Mirchi Jimmy. I'm in conversation with the inscription stone hunters, Vinay and Uday. Uday isn't here. Vinay is. We're talking about how they got on this journey to find these inscription stones that were written almost 1200 years ago and are lying across Bangalore. There's one in Pattandur, there's one in Dasarahalli. Now, these are stones that have some little carving on them, a picture, and then there's some text on it as well. Vinay, I'm sure you have like hajar fascinating stories to share with us. One last one before you go, about how the villagers react, at least, when you find the stone and you tell them what's written on the stone.
Interestingly, we were at one place called Chikkabettahalli.
Okay.
Near Vidyaranyapura. Huh.
There is a stone inscription behind a temple there, and when we first landed there, this whole place was filled with trash.
Okay.
We were trying to clear the trash, and local people came by and said, hey, what are you guys doing?
Huh.
This is nothing important. Why are you cleaning this place? So then we told them, this is a story of your place. Here, we will read it out for you. And once we read out the whole story, the villagers found out that particular village, this is like in the heart of Bangalore today, as a link to the Vijayanagar Empire.
Okay.
To the reign of Krishnadevaraya, when the local chieftain under Krishnadevaraya, who ruled this place, gave a donation to another village called Singapura, which is nearby.
Okay.
So these people were like really proud of it. They're like, oh wow, our ancestors have done such nice things. We have been so ignorant. And in half an hour, they cleaned up the whole place. And then at the end of it, they were so proud of what they had done for their own village. And they were like, okay, we learned about our village now. So let's do a Facebook Live.
Okay.
Started a Facebook Live and started reading out what is written on that inscription stone. And somebody in Singapura, which is a nearby village, was tuning into this Facebook Live. And they heard the name Singapura. And they were surprised. Why is somebody in Chikkabettahalli talking about our village, Singapura? And so he reached out to us, Mr. Mohan from Singapura. It turns out that he had seen some stone like that in Singapura.
Okay.
He had no clue what it was. And he says, there could be some stone here similar to what people are talking in Chikkabettahalli. Can you please come? And to our surprise, we found an inscription stone from the 15th century.
Whoa.
Which was never documented before. People believe that Singapura is a name borrowed from Singapore. But it is not so. Singapura is many hundred years older than Singapore. And Singapura is named after possibly a leader called Singappa Nayaka who lived there. And all this is the information we get from inscription stones.
From one stone. They have 3D scanned these stones and are making metal replicas that you can own. That's on the anvil. So not only can you own a piece of our history, such beautiful stories, but also help in preserving this history. They haven't figured out how to do the selling and what to price it at. So if you're interested in any of this, then follow them on their Twitter handle. Look for Inscription Stones Bangalore or their Facebook page, Inscription Stones Bangalore. This is Mirchi 95. I am Mirchi Jimmy. Mirchi Sunne Wale. Always Khush. Good morning, Bangalore.